morning, and I sometimes think that when we were in Sanborn Hall, we were a little closer together, but it's good to see you all, and as we worship our God together. And I hope that you find the worship service meaningful. We do have communion this morning. We're going to be doing it still with grapes and bread, but not with bags. We're going to try something a little different, so and we'll bring it to you. So I would invite the children to come up. $80, right? And we're missing a few kids, so we might be able to do more. What do you think we could do with that money? If you collected money, it wouldn't have to be quarters. You could put any amount in there. The quarters just have to be a little bit bigger. So, what do you think you could do with that money? What do you think we could do with it to help someone else? The homeless culture, Lily, Elsie. Give it to poor people. You could give it to UNCOR, which is where they're helping out in Ukraine. We could give it to a lot of other different places. So if that's something that you can decide, but I thought maybe I'd give you a couple of weeks, like this week and the next week, and then we're at what day? Easter. Easter. So on Easter Sunday, I'm going to give you these to take with you today, but I'm not going to give them to you now. I'll give them to your teacher to give to you for after Sunday school. And I promise you, I did not open your hands. So you can take these, and first you'll have to empty it. I know that's going to be a chore to have to eat all those M&Ms, right? But you can empty the M&Ms. You can eat the M&Ms. And then if you start to find like loose change on the ground, anybody can do this, by the way. You don't even need the M&Ms, although they're nice. But if you find loose change on the ground, if you haven't, Dave and I take our change out every night and stick it in a little container, and then we take it to the bank, or we give it to somebody, you know, give it to the poor, or give it to a group. So we do that every day. So, and we've got two classes going, so we'll have to share, but why don't I give it to Kelly and she can take it down, and then afterwards she will bring them into you, and whatever's left over we'll bring up here and hold on to some for the family and grandkids. So let's pray. Dear God, help us to help others. Help us to find quarters or nickels or dimes or pennies
or
maybe even dollar bills. May you bless this time as we go to Sunday school. We pray in Jesus' name.
Pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
See you later.
Jesus is with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus in their home. every time we worship together. You are with us always. Help us to recognize your presence as we hear the word, pray, sing, and praise you today. Help us to recognize the signs of your presence with us.
Amen.
Now please stand as you're comfortable and join in singing the hymn, Dear Lord Jesus.
Thanks be to God.
But on Sundays, we often come looking for a resting place. A place where we can refresh and renew and be together as your church to prepare and renew ourselves so we can go forward and go out into the world where we bring your church into the world. So today, as we worship together, lift us up and fill our hearts with your love and your care that we might go and share it with others. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Going on a journey, for most of us at least, isn't like just jumping in the car and taking off, although I know a few people who have done that. Generally, planning and preparation precede the trip. I make a list of what I'm taking. Dave thinks I'm crazy, but I make a list as I'm going along, trying to think of everything I might need on the way, and it does make packing a lot easier for me, so that's why I do it. Of course, there's figuring out what roads to take or for those places where we've never been, and we need to make reservations or arrangements or accommodations wherever we might be going. When my siblings and I were younger, we never started a trip, no matter how long it would be, without one very important question in preparation for the trip my parents would ask right before we got into the car. You know what it is. Does anybody need to go to the bathroom? Yeah. Now, as I grow older, I ask myself that question all the time. And I don't need to be sure that as I'm traveling, I know where all the rest stops are along the way, just in case. And by the way, Massachusetts Turnpike and the New York Thruway have these great rest stops that are evenly spaced. You can time it just right. Going out to Iowa, we found that out several times. It is those rest stops that help me to get through the trip. And of course, they also show us that we can find some downtime and to be wise as we take that downtime. We've learned to adjust our ETA so that we can accommodate those rest stops. On any journeys, time to stop, stretch, grab a bite to eat, or refresh ourselves is what helps us to keep on going down the road. And that's also important as we go on our spiritual journeys down that road. Today's passage happened not too long after Lazarus had been raised from the dead, and the disciples didn't want Jesus to go to Bethany, a small village outside of Jerusalem, because they knew that if he showed up there, he would certainly be arrested and probably thrown in jail, if not put to death. And so they tried to discourage him from going, and yet Jesus knew that that wasn't the voice, those weren't the voices he needed to hear. He held steadfastly to his journey toward his mission and ministry, toward the cross, and despite the disciples' warnings. Those were tense times in Israel, especially in Jerusalem. King Herod was ruthless in getting rid of anyone who might threaten his position as king, including having his own sons murdered so that they couldn't take over whatever position he had. And Pontius Pilate did whatever he needed to do as a Roman governor in order to keep peace in Israel. Well, his way of keeping peace was to keep the Jewish nation subdued and obedient to Caesar, even if it meant crucifying insurrectionists and throwing others in prison. He did what he had to do, and it was violent and not pretty. Throughout the centuries, we have seen the same patterns of violence, power struggles, control, and war in order for someone to keep the peace. Sadly, not much has changed over those centuries, and we see it happening over and over again, most recently in Ukraine. Anyone who was associated with Jesus could be arrested. And Jesus stayed out of the public eye for a little while since he knew that his time was coming, but it wasn't there yet. Because of the raising of Lazarus, though, many people started to believe in Jesus, which became a threat to a group of temple leaders. And if we were to read a few more verses beyond what Yvonne just read, in verses 9 through 11, we read, many Jews learned that he was there. They came not only because of Jesus, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. The chief priests decided they would kill Lazarus too. It was because of Lazarus that many Jews had deserted them and come to believe in Jesus. So Jesus recognized the dangers that faced him, but he also knew that his mission was something he was called to fulfill, and he forged ahead. He knew his life was in danger. The disciples knew it. Lazarus, Mary, and Martha knew it. It wore on them. And there was tension, anxiety, and this heaviness that hung over them. But there was also celebration because Lazarus was alive. So the brother and two sisters hosted a banquet in his honor to express their gratitude and their love for him. This was a rest stop on the journey, a preparation time, a time to regroup and build up his defenses. And they shared a meal together as a time of respite during the challenging journey, the one that faced them not very long in the future. In understanding this, I think it's helpful for us to think about those times in our lives when we've been together with family and friends as we celebrate the death of a loved one, not the death of a loved one, but celebrate the life of someone who has died. Grief can weigh us down and overwhelm us, and getting through a funeral can be challenging, to say the least, as everybody here probably knows. The circumstances leading up to the death can influence how we grieve too. Yet there's a type of respite or resting stop that happens when people surround us with love and support and care for us. They share our grief and carry it with us, even though it is for just a short amount of time. Most of us, pastors particularly, have called these gatherings a celebration of life so that we remember that we're not just celebrating or thinking about the death of the person, but celebrating all of who they were, the whole life of who they were, and how they have left a legacy for everyone who knew them. I can't even count the number of funerals I have either attended or officiated at, but each one is different and special according to the person who has died. One of the most meaningful services or meaningful celebrations of life was one that I didn't attend in a church. It wasn't religious at all. It was a potluck gathering for family and friends of Day's aunt, Barbara. Barbara lived a long and happy, sometimes challenging life. And when she died, Day's cousins invited everyone to join them at the community room in the complex where she had her apartment. They showed videos, they had pictures of Barbara, and the family Barbara and the family were everywhere. Lots of people came to pay their respects. The place was loaded with people. They celebrated her life, they swapped stories, they had some food, and they just celebrated. They laughed, which Barbara would have loved that they were laughing at her memorial service, but she was a special lady. Why not celebrate her life? And it was evident in the number of people who took the time to be there to express the journey, to express their love for her and her family, and it helped that family then to deal more with their grief, knowing they had others who were supporting and caring about them and encouraging them. And they kept on, we all have too, carrying the love for Barbara with them. After Lazarus died and had already been buried, Mary and Martha greeted Jesus outside the tomb when he arrived. Both of them were in mourning, and both told him that Lazarus would not have died if only Jesus had been there. Mary and Martha believed that Jesus was the Messiah. They told him that, and their loss and grief moved him deeply to the point where he stood with them and wept. But then he lifted his voice in prayer to God and hollered, "Lazarus, come out!" And Lazarus, still wrapped in grave clothes, came out of the tomb. He had been restored to his family, and Jesus had once again shown that God had power over death. It was out of our immense gratitude and love for Jesus. It was out of their immense gratitude and love for Jesus, and ours too, that they gathered as a small band of disciples and friends to celebrate Lazarus's life with Lazarus in their midst. And it was in the middle of this celebration, in the quiet of their home, that Mary poured her heart out in a very unexpected way. As they gathered around the table, Mary arrived with a jar of very costly perfume made of pure nard, which is a more solid compound, very expensive and usually used to anoint the dead, maybe even left over from when they had buried Lazarus. We can guess that the room when Mary appeared went totally silent as the others watched her. All eyes were on her. And the disciples, who had been curious at first as she broke the seal in the jar, on the jar and poured or put the ointment on Jesus' feet, she knew she was doing the right thing. She knew she was supposed to care for him. She focused on Jesus as she blessed him with the aromatic oil, the nard, and offered her love and care for him. Although Judas criticized her for wasting such costly oil, Jesus defended her. He stood up for her. He honored her gift. He valued what she had done. He knew she had done the right thing. He knew that she had anointed him for his burial. Reverend Sue Lodge wrote, "Mary is the only one who anoints him as the Holy One of God, who will shortly be crucified under the title King of the Jews. Mary provides the only preparation for burial that Jesus will receive before being hurriedly placed in the tomb. And while the rest of the disciples are becoming agitated in response to the mounting drama and the increasing likelihood of violence, it is Mary who pours out extravagantly the sweet-smelling ointment that seems to give Jesus great comfort." This was a rest stop for Jesus on this journey, a safe place where he could receive care and love, the kind of care and love that helped him to move forward to what awaited him in the next week, the final week of his life on earth. This rest stop on his journey was a place where he could take a deep breath, pray, receive, honor, enjoy, and love his friends. The rest stops on our journeys of faith are times when we take time out to do the same type of thing. Our lives are so busy and full. Just try to look at somebody's calendar once in a while who is, you know, busy. I can't imagine some of you who have lots of children or other things going on. Our schedules are busy, we keep busy, and we don't often stop to take time to rest and renew and restore ourselves so that we can keep on keeping on. The journey of faith is challenging with ups and downs, twists and turns, and so often the unexpected happens and throws us off. There are times when God touches our life unexpectedly, and often through unexpected people. Sometimes we have negative reactions to God because God doesn't meet our expectations. Maybe we're disappointed because we expected God to answer our prayers the way we wanted them to be answered, or to help our sports team win, or to bring some kind of punishment to someone who had wronged us, or to help us get a promotion. Jesus didn't place his expectations on God, but lived accepting God's expectations of him. He received the unexpected gift of anointing from Mary, and he recognized it as one more step on his journey toward the cross, helping him to stay on course, focused on God and on the mission he had been called to. We sometimes take the wrong road, and that is often when we most need to find a rest stop where we can pray, reflect, review, relax, and do what we need to do to think things through with God's help or with the family, help of family and friends. Maybe we ask, well, what do you want me to do, God? I mean, I always ask that, and sometimes I hear an answer. Sometimes I wish I could just pick up the phone and hear the answer. Where are you leading me? The answer may not come immediately, and it may come through a friend or as an insight or some other way at a rest stop that we've taken on the path of faith. Whatever it is, we are called to continue the journey, to trust in God's guidance, and to regroup and keep trying. Don't give up. Reverend Sue Lodge gives us food for thought at this rest stop in our Lenten journey. Indeed, when we come to reflect on what this strange story can mean to us in our contemporary situation, it is, I think, the invitation to anoint Jesus in our time by glimpsing the inbreaking of the reign of God's holy love and peace in those persons and situations around us, to attend to those in front of us with tender and attentive love, and to do what we can even when we cannot prevent suffering. And by so doing, to proclaim hope even in the face of much opposition, violence, and fear. We may not be able to halt the war in Ukraine or end the pandemic or limit the impact of climate change quickly or radically enough to prevent the great suffering that we see, But let us not look away in despair or fear. Instead, like Mary, let us give our tender best when and where we can. And if enough of us follow Mary's example, then we may indeed be making a holy difference. Let us find our rest stops. Take a deep breath, pray, reach out to others, care about and for others, bring Christ to others. And let us continue our journeys, bring along what we have learned, and continue growing in faith.
For some of you, you've heard this song, and I finally get to sing it with the man who actually purchased it for us. Steve Scott, in the back, brought this to me and asked if I would sing it. So, Steve, it's for you. At his table.
Dear God, How easy it is for us to distinguish ourselves from others. For the times we believe we are better than others, forgive us. For the times we put our ways on a pedestal to the neglect of others, forgive us. For the times we avert our gaze so we won't have to look at someone else's condition, forgive us. For the times we wish they would all go away and live somewhere else, forgive us. For the times we feel no discomfort in judging others before we even know them, forgive us. For the ease with which we label people, them and other, forgive us. Hear the good news. Through Jesus Christ, we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins. God hears, God cares, God forgives. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now we'll do the invitation to Holy Communion. Dear friends, we are going to Jerusalem with Jesus.
He is our pardon, our healing, and our peace.
We will suffer the trial with him, resisting evil.
With him, we will walk the path to life.
But come first to the table where there is food for the journey.
With hearts full of joy we come, giving thanks to God, our Maker, and offering our praise.
We are right to praise you, faithful God. You answer sin with grace. You guide our wayward steps toward home. You are mending for the broken, safety for the poor, belonging for the outcast, strength for the weak, and pardon for the sinner. You reveal your kindness in every sorrow, your mercy even in death. All your creatures see your works. They sing of your steadfast love. We too declare your wonder and grace as with angels and saints we say, Holy, 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 Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Okay. I think it's happened. We'll do the prayers of the people, I promise. Thank you. Now, O God, we remember Jesus. He fasted and prayed. He was tempted and tried.
He relied on you for everything.
He was obedient to you and scorned by the powers of this world.
He confounded the haughty and gave hope to the humble.
He was betrayed and deserted. He died between thieves and was buried in a borrowed grave.
He gave you new life. He lives even now, our healer and friend.
He loved us well, loved us to the end, loves us still.
Even on the night of betrayal, he ate supper with his friends.
Over 2,000 years ago, Jesus ate the Passover meal with his disciples in an upper room in Jerusalem. After they finished the ceremonial meal, Jesus took the bread, thanked God for it, broke it, and gave it to his friends, This is my body, which is given to you. Take and eat it in remember me. Then he took a cup of wine, thanked God for it, and said to his friends, "This is my blood given to you as a new agreement between humans and God. Drink it and remember me." Just as the grain that was used to make this bread was once scattered over the land and then gathered together to make this loaf, O God, gather your people together from all over the world into your one holy and eternal community. This is Christ's dinner table. Christ welcomes everyone who wants to know him to come and eat and meet with him here. Prayer to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come. Make all things new. Bless this bread which you have given and human hands have made. Let it become for us the bread of life. Bless also this cup, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. Let it become for us the cup or the fruit of salvation. Bless us also who eat and share this meal together, that in this sharing we may know the living Christ who is with us now and to the end of the age. Nourish us by these gifts to be willing servants of your world until your kingdom comes and every creature beholds it. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Yvonne and I will come down the aisles, and we have these cups that have both a grape and bread in them. And I would invite you to hold your cup in till we're all ready to take it together. Eat your meal.
Celebration, sharing with the community. That's great. So,
no rest.
I didn't hear.
No rest.
No masks.
No masks.
I'm thankful to be back here today.
Thankful to have Marilyn here. Lord, hear our prayers. And now we will, I invite you to offer your gifts as we continue to find ways that we support the mission and ministry of this church, both locally and beyond.
Thank you.
earth, the bread and the grapes, for the money that has been given and the hearts and souls that we offer to you as your children. We ask your blessing. Use them to your glory. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to join in our hymn, Here I Am, Lord. Given them to share. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.